fieldwork is fun but challenging because you never know when you will be able to sleep again.
But if you love bottle washing, trace metal work can be for you.
This is the most challenging but exciting job I've ever had.
I'm Rebecca Zitoun, and today we are doing a tour of the Trace Metal Clean Laboratory here at NIOZ. The Trace Metal Clean Laboratory is part of the Trace Metal Clean Working Group here at NIOZ, led by Rob Middock, Luz, Mathijs, Stanley, Patrick, Bas, myself, and we currently have an intern called Iza. So now let's talk about why is it important to measure trace metals in the ocean. We study trace metals because phytoplankton, which are microscopically tiny plants, in the ocean and form the base of the marine food web, account for about half of the primary production in the ocean, meaning that they produce 50% of the ocean we are breathing every day. And they also contribute to the removal of carbon dioxide, which is really important because we are facing a lot of CO2 emissions at the moment. In order to grow phytoplankton, as well as any other organism in the ocean, we need macronutrients like nitrate, phosphate, silicate, and carbon. But we also need trace metals such as copper, iron, cobalt, and zinc. So studying the distribution, concentration, and the cycling of trace metal in the ocean is of fundamental importance because first of all, they influence the primary productivity in the ocean. They influence the species composition in the ocean because trace metals can be beneficial or toxic. And ultimately, they change and influence the global carbon cycling and also thereby the climate. But there's a tricky part to studying trace metals and analyzing them in the ocean. Despite metals being relatively high in the terrestrial sphere and really abundant, there are really low concentrations of metals in the ocean. To give you an idea of how low the concentrations can be, for example, if you want to measure iron, measuring iron in seawater is like finding one tiny needle in a million of haystacks. So how do we sample these vanishingly low concentrations of trace metals in the ocean without contaminating our samples with trace metals which are present in the terrestrial sphere? I can tell you, it's really challenging, time-consuming, and costly. First, we have to clean our bottles with detergent and acid to get rid of the organics and the metals. And then we have to double bag them before filling them with clean acid. And that can take a few weeks depending on how many bottles we have to clean for a certain project. When we clean the bottles and we double bag them, we do that in a trace metal clean laboratory. We call it a class 100 trace metal clean lab because the atmosphere we are working in has less than 100 dust particles of the size of 0.5 microns. So all the sample handling we are doing and all the bagging will be performed in a fume hood to avoid further contamination, and we also have to wear a special outfit. So we have to wear a special suit, we have to wear special clothes, a hairnet, and shoes. When we go on a ship to sample our water, we do that with a trace metal clean rosette to sample the water column, and the trace metal clean rosette is out of a certain material which doesn't include a lot of trace metals. When the trace metal rosette comes on ship again, we put it in a trace metal clean container to avoid more contamination, and in the container we can then filter our water and fill them in bottles and ship these bottles back to the home laboratory. All the filtering, of course, will be done in our trace metal clean suit. Back in the home lab, we can then analyze the samples we collected on the ship for dissolved trace metals, particulate trace metals, ligands, and isotopes. So now let's talk, how do we actually measure the minuscule concentrations of trace metals we are collecting out at sea?
So measuring the concentration of dissolved trace metals in seawater, meaning metals with a size smaller than 0.2 micrometer, that sounds quite straightforward. But the complex seawater matrix interferes with a lot of instruments, which make the measurement of low concentrations quite tricky actually. So here at NIOZ we use an instrument called the SeaFast to get rid of this saltwater matrix of a sample via column chemistry, and at the same time it pre-concentrates the sample for the ICP-MS measurement. We can, in this way, pre-concentrate the sample up to 60 times, and that gives us actually plenty of signal on the ICP-MS for an accurate concentration measurement. So, the CFAST is actually quite fast, as the name reveals. A sample can be done within 20 minutes, and another advantage is that you only need 20 mil for a single run. So, which that means that we can easily make a triplicate measurement, for instance, which is very important for analytical chemistry. So, besides dissolved, we also measure particulate trace metals, and that are metals bigger in size than 0.2 micrometer. The particulates are directly filtered at sea, and the filters with the particulates on them are stored in the freezer until analysis at NIOZ. So we filter up to, let's say, I think 8 liters of water or less, which is a bit depending on the amount of material in the filter. So the samples are already concentrated enough to be measured on our ICP-MS, and sometimes you actually have to dilute them to get an accurate measurement. So for one sample filter, we usually try to separate two fractions. First, we use a weak acidic acid leach to collect the what we call Labau fraction. The Labau fraction is mostly biogenic and they decompose very rapidly. When that is finished, we use a strong HF leach to get all the rest of the material of the filter, and we call this the refractory fraction. And refractory means that it is very resistant to degradation and it can actually persist in the ocean for millennia.
The dissolved and the particulate data does not only give us an idea of the concentration and the distribution of metals in the ocean, it also gives us information on dominant processes and the intensity as well as rate. If we, of course, know what processes affect the concentration in the first place. Additionally, this data forms the basis for other essential trace metal analysis, such as ligands and isotopes. Ligands, which are organic molecules, are very important in trace metal chemistry, since they keep the bioactive trace metals like iron, copper, cobalt, and zinc in solution, so they keep them in the dissolved phase, thereby preventing them from being precipitated and removed from the water column. For instance, usually 99% of our iron and copper in the ocean is organically bound to ligands, which keeps them bioavailable for the organisms which need these trace elements to grow and live. But in the case of copper, for example, copper can be very toxic to to organisms above a certain threshold. So it's really important that some organisms are able to bind the toxic copper away. So despite the importance, little is actually known about the chemical structure and architecture of ligands in seawater. So here at NIOZ we are using an indirect approach to evaluate ligands in seawater. We use electrochemical techniques, also referred to as voltammetry, to quantify the concentration of ligands in the water column and get an idea of the binding constants, which gives us a rough characterization of the ligands in seawater. However, this method is very costly, really time consuming. We can only measure 2 to 3 samples in 2 days, which is really slow. And it also requires specific instruments and a lot of expertise. So as such, not many laboratories in the world are doing this kind of analysis. So as you've just heard, organic complexation of metals plays a vital role in the biogeochemical cycling of trace metals in our ocean. But now let's step away from ligands and let's talk about isotopes, which is one of the other important research sections we do here at NIOZ.
Our team is interested in isotope compositions of trace metal in the ocean, especially bioactive metals such as iron, zinc, and cadmium. The isotope composition preserves the information of different biogeochemical processes that are happening in the ocean. For example, in most cases, phytoplankton loves lighter isotopes. So their uptake of trace metals leaves heavier isotope signatures in seawater. Moreover, the binding between organic matters and the trace metals could also alter trace metal isotopic compositions. For example, one specific iron binding ligand called siderophore prefer to bind heavier iron isotopes, which could result in lighter isotope signatures in seawater. And this is what we call isotope fractionation, which happens in multiple ways and result in unique isotope signatures in the ocean. So we can take use of this to not only study their roles in all these processes, but also fingerprint the sources of trace metals to better understand their distributions in the ocean. One of the challenges of measuring trace metal isotope composition is the extremely low concentrations. As we already knew, the concentration of trace metal are pretty low in seawater, and the concentration of each isotope is even lower. And that is why we need a trace metal clean working environment to minimize the contamination. Additionally, unlike CFAST, we need to pre-concentrate even larger amount of seawater to be able to detect trace metal isotopes on the multi-collector ICP-MS. For instance, there's not much iron in the Southern Ocean, and it's usually below 0.2 nanomole in the surface. And in this case, we have to pre-concentrate 2 to 4 liters of seawater to get measurable iron isotopes. And for this, we develop a manual extraction system using no-bias PA1 resin to extract various metals of interest from the major metrics. And to avoid elemental interference on certain isotopes, we made these kind of microcolumns loaded with HGMP1 resin to separate the different metals from each other by eluting with different reagents. And in the end, we collect different fractions for the isotopic measurement. There is still a lot of unknowns about trace metal isotopic composition in the ocean, and to be working in such clean lab requires some trainings and being especially meticulous. But you will give you a great sense of achievement when you got good data.
As you just heard, we're really busy here at NIOZ, and we are always keen to understand more and more about the biogeochemical cycles of trace metals in the ocean to be able to predict what is going to happen in the future. So questions on how continued global warming, pollution, and climate change will change trace metal chemistry in the future are of particular interest for us here at NIOZ. And if you're looking for more information about research on trace metal chemistry, then check out the GeoTracer's website or the website of NIOZ.